Very good afternoon and a nice warm welcome to all of you, because the weather, even in a cool city like Bangalore, is continuously rising. Temperatures are going up much more than before. As we know, global warming is taking place, and along with that, all the exams are happening. So innumerable students going through different types of exams. A few of them have completed their exams, so they are celebrating now. And at the end of the academic year, what does it mean? The summer vacation means holidays. And holidays inevitably means travel. Try and recollect the good old days when you were a child. You did not even feel the pressure of the hot sun. You did not, feel bad about the dust and the crowds and whatever it is. You didn't mind jumping into trains, changing trains, sitting in a train for 24 hours to reach your destination. Those were the holidays of the good old days when we were children. At least elders like me have very good recollections of those good old days when summer rush, you wouldn't even get reservations, so you used to be tumbling over each other with all the baggage and luggage and everything, and going. Very, very few people could afford air travel. Most of the people went by trains and buses, and yet those holidays were very, very enjoyable as children. Anyway, let me first talk about, the way this concept of holidays and vacation started. Few generations back, when our forefathers were mostly living in villages, the vacations used to be based on the festivals. So you have the harvest festival, you have the end of the winter and starting of the warm days festival, you have Dasara, you have Diwali. These were the important festivals, and the whole village used to celebrate all together. Every person used to stop whatever activities, shut down, and come to enjoy the festivals. So there would be music, there would be nautankis, there would be people coming and giving some gyan or talking about some religious chants. All that one after another would go on, and then of course there would be food. The homemakers traditionally would always be overworked because of the festivals, but everybody else had a lovely free time enjoying themselves and doing whatever they wanted. And this was also a concept where everybody got to know each other better, because you are free from your responsibilities and your work, and you would sit and do, chit chat, get to know each other. The other concept of holiday and vacation in those days used to be marriages. So if there is a marriage of a relative or a close person, few hours journey away, everybody would pile up, go and land up there. And there no fancy hotels or whatever it is. People used to live in each other's houses. People used to somehow accommodate 5 guests, 15 guests. And then a lot of cooking used to go on, a lot of things. And then the wedding festivities and this and that, finish that. And come back. So what happened was that there was this compulsory holidays and breaks. You could not say no if there was a marriage in the family. You could not say that let everybody else celebrate Ugadi, I will go to my field and I will work or I will do what I want to do. No. It was compulsory that you had to take a break. And that was the beauty of the holidays. See, there is no doubt about it that human beings cannot, work 24/7 into 365. Even your phone, the so-called very smart phone, has a battery which runs down, and then you have to recharge it. You have to stop using the phone, you have to connect it for charging and wait for it to be recharged, and then again it gives you wonderful service. More so with human beings. What happened over a period of time is that when we migrated from the villages to the cities and when we became nuclear families and all that, all these common festivals got over. And when that was done, we started looking at work and holidays as individuals or at the most as small family units. And then with competition with this and that, for example, every year, maybe till about 20 years back, summer means all schools and all colleges would shut down. So even if daddy was busy and he could not get leave for so many days, he would send off his wife and children to wherever his parents' house or wherever the vacation is happening. And then he would come for a few days, depending on how much leave is allowed to him. He would come and spend those few days, and then everybody would probably come back together. But today, as you know, the one casualty has been innumerable, you know, exams and tests and competition and entrance exams. Today, most of the children, once they come up to 10th standard and beyond, they just do not get a full-fledged summer vacation. If one child has vacation, the other child doesn't have it. Those who are in 9th standard are told that, okay, 9th standard annual exam is over. We are immediately going to start off with 10th standard portions because it is your board exam year. So starting with children, we are depriving them of something which they really need. If they work for, you know, 10 months, if they study hard, they give the exams. At the end of the exams, they should have the pleasure of freaking out, going away from the routine and from home and learning something new in terms of vacations. Learning about life more than learning from the textbooks. The other thing that has happened is that there are so many people I come across who are in the type of jobs where they can't take leave. This way, I'm in a very responsible position. Some of them don't admit, but what they're scared of is that if I take long leave, I may even lose my job. Somebody else may come in my place. Then there are other people who are told that you have this project and you have these deliverables. So on certain such date, this project has to be completed and handed over. So no question of your going out even for a few days till that thing is over. And by the time the thing is over, the children have already started the new academic year, and that's the end of it. So this is something which has been concerning me a lot. I think vacations with your family, be it elderly parents, be it the middle generation, be it the children, they all need to close down whatever they are doing and get away from their places. And get away where? That is the other thing that is happening. People are going to places which are thick with crowds. Take even pilgrimages, for example. You go to some famous temples and there is not a square inch of place. It is more crowded than the city. So people who are religious minded and they want to go on pilgrimages and all that, they find that they are coming back totally exhausted. Same thing with marriages. You have some muhurtam at 3 a.m. You have to spend the whole night, you know, all decked up and all that, and sitting and waiting for whatever is happening. And then there are innumerable people gossiping, backbiting with each other. Probably you're in a place which is hot and dusty and you really don't enjoy. The accommodation is not really luxurious or to your liking. Now, these are the type of things which are happening to us. I find people who compulsorily have to take an off when there is a wedding of their second cousin. But otherwise, if you ask them that you and your family, your children, etc., why don't you take a break? Why don't you, you know, go somewhere where you can just, you know, stretch out, relax, be by yourself, and build better relationship with your family members, your elders, as well as your children, your siblings, whoever it is who you can be, closer to. If you have your parents living with you, for example, in the normal routine, there is bound to be friction. The grandparents don't like the way the parents are bringing up the child. They have certain requirements which the children cannot fulfill. All that is going on. But once you take them out somewhere for a vacation, the whole, you know, dynamics changes. You're all there to enjoy something. And according to me, you do not have to go to great luxurious places or, you know, very expensive and far away places. Today, people are going by air much more than they are going by train. The number of flights taking off from each airport and the number of airports that have, you know, multiplied. Today, every middle town also has an airport and people are happily traveling by air, the type of money that they are spending. When you used to go by either rail or by road, there was an enjoyment, there was an experience, there was a learning even in the journey. Now here it's a 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour flight and that's the end of it. You don't get to see anything. You don't get to see what all other places that you've gone past, whether you went by train or bus or your own car. There was so much to see on the journey. So much that you can look around, learn and find out new things about different places. All that is gone when you're traveling by air. Even I find some people, they are going on their honeymoon, but they are being told by their elders that you have to visit A, B, C, D, E temples. They've got their whole life to visit temples and to pray and whatever it is. This is a time for the newlyweds to bond with each other, to have time exclusive for themselves, where they have no commitments. They don't have to worry about going into some temples or rituals or anything else. They're just by themselves. And that is when they start with their first level of understanding and bonding with each other. All this we are neglecting to a great extent. And that worries me a lot. There is also, you know, this rich-poor divide, which is getting more and more wider. Last year, at the time of Christmas, New Year, I was told that in one of the very, very popular hill stations in North India, all the five-star hotels were fully booked. And the middle-level hotels had 60-70% bookings. Imagine there are people willing to pay 20,000 rupees a day, but there aren't sufficient people to take rooms at 2,000 rupees a day. What is this indicating? And those who are going into those luxury hotels, the idea of a hill station is to get into nature. But if you're going to be in a centrally air-conditioned building, what's the purpose? Why go all the way to a hill station? You can be right in your own city. Very, very insignificant things apparently, but to me they are a lot of concern, and that's why I chose this topic of today at a time when, you know, March is coming to an end and April, May are generally the times when people can afford to go out, take some vacations. One of the most important things is children learn life skills in vacations. If you give them an opportunity to explore, to meet new people, to be amongst nature and amongst different types of environments. If you go into those things, children will actually learn life skills. And of course, you should have an environment where the children can keep on asking questions. Children get very curious when they see new things. But is there somebody to answer their questions? That is very important. And that is an opportunity for, you know, children. If you can plan well, we still have time. If you haven't planned out your summer vacation, please do it now. And my sincere request is go into nature. There's abundance of nature in our country. You don't have to go abroad. You don't have to spend in foreign exchange. There is not only abundance of nature, but every place in our country has holidays or accommodations or resorts, which are, like I was telling you just now, it may be 20,000 per day, it may be 2,000 per day. So depending on your pocket, you can go to the same place and choose whatever suits your budget. It hardly makes a difference, because once you step out of your room and you're moving around, you are the same whether you are a 20,000 person or a 2,000 person. There are home stays. There are so many resorts, you know, which if you select carefully, they are at a very, very reasonable cost. But the most important thing is to ensure that you are with nature. Elders will enjoy that. They will have nostalgia of the good old days. Children will be fascinated if you teach them about nature. And today's children, who are digital natives, who are stuck to the screens of their laptops or their smartphones, if you can tell them that other than emergency use, no carrying laptops with you and no switching on the mobile phones. A true vacation of today, in this year 2024, is if you can take your vacation without gadgets. If you have the courage and if you can leave them behind and go, wonderful. If you can't do that, at least take it, put it away in the cupboard of your room and roam around, come back after a few hours, check if there was any urgent or emergency call, call them back and do whatever has to be done. But make sure that you are away from technology. And like I was telling you, there is so much abundance of nature in our own country. It depends on what you want to choose. You can go to seaside places, you can go to hills, you can go to places where there are wonderful lakes and water bodies. You can go to just about any type of place that you can think of. What we did was that I was just asking Sonal that, can you pull out a few photographs of some places which have abandoned nature? So she pulled out some very nice and very fascinating photographs, and Anis will show them to you. Here is a lovely hillside road, and if you look behind the cars, you see a number of waterfalls. You can just sit in a place like this and watch that for endless time. It's so fascinating. You see the clouds above. The clouds are almost hitting the hills. The road is wet with rain, and you have this lovely series of waterfalls. Then have a look at this. Climb up on top of a hill, sit down on the rock and look down into the valley. Again, you see clouds. You see so much farms and open areas. You see some villages. You can sit and watch that. Depending on where you are, you can either watch the sunrise or the sunset. Then look at this nice little water body. You have, these are generally called backwaters, and you have these small boats, very inexpensive. You can go and take a boat ride in any of these boats, go around, look at nature, look at the trees, look at the birds, take a round and come back. Then you have the seaside, nice, uncongested beach. People are walking around. If you see, there are these, you know, the stone pathway where the adventurous people are walking towards the sea. The others are happy playing in the sand. You can possibly spend a whole day on the beach like this. Then we have the deserts. You see this string of camels going past in the desert. That is an enjoyment by itself. If you go there and plan out accordingly, you won't even feel the heat of the desert, the fascination of that camel rides, the type of places that you will see which you do not get to see at home. Here is a lovely family. Look at them, the elders, the middle generation, the kid. What they have done is they have packed their food, they have gone on a road journey, they have stopped their car, spread out the dari, taken out all the food that they have brought from home, sitting nicely under the shade of a tree and enjoying a meal. I tell you, this is far better than eating in a 5-star hotel. The flip side of it, snow. We have many places in our country which have snow, right up to February, March also. Give your children an opportunity to play around in the snow. If you live in South India, you won't. You'll obviously have never had the privilege of, running around and playing around in the snow. That's an experience by itself. You can have campfires, nice campfires. When the night comes in and when it becomes cool and when the breeze starts, you sit around, get some chairs or get some daris, get some wood, have a campfire and do whatever you want, singing, antakshri, playing some instruments, cracking some jokes, talking to each other. Lovely evening, you can spend hours in that campfire. Then you have the sea, you have boats, you have lovely power boats which take you at good speed. Or like I had shown you in the previous slide, you have those small little canoes. Take your choice. Go around. For people who live in cities like Bangalore and all, which are away from the seaside, this is a wonderful experience that you can go to the seaside and see the expanse of the sea. It is so fascinating to see how spread out the sea can be, what voluminous it is. Here is another interesting one. All these people have got together on the elephant and they are having a joyride. If you or your children have never sat on an elephant, do it now before elephants become extinct. Here's a resort with a swimming pool and a small wading pool for the little ones who can't go into the big pool. And you have these relaxing chairs in the background, you can see. Just stretch yourself out on that. Pull it so that you are under the shade of a big tree and you don't feel the heat. Let the children waddle around in the wading pool. Or you can also jump in into the waters. And particularly in summer when the heat is high, you can thoroughly enjoy a nice, cool swimming pool. So, these are just a few examples, which, as I said, we sort of just pulled it out from here and there and we brought it for you just to help you to understand what is the possibility that we can do. I have had the privilege of, going to various places, mostly because of the military people who invite me to their different stations. I have been to the Northeast, I have been to the North, I have been to the South, I have been most of these places. And though I went on work, training work for those people, it was more than a vacation for me. Similarly, you can also, if you feel like, you can combine some amount of work along with a good vacation if you need to earn money or if you need to feel useful. Even that is possible. Next time you're attending a conference somewhere and all that, take your family along. While you are at the conference, the family will go shopping or roaming around. Once your conference is over, spend some time with them in the same place or nearby place and make it into a nice vacation and come back. The idea that I am trying to emphasize on is that you should use this, number one, to learn life skills, to be out into the open and nature. What nature teaches us, nothing else can teach. Nature teaches us the importance of delayed gratification. Nature teaches us how there is a hierarchy from the biggest animals to the smallest animals. And yet, there are innumerable small animals who survive despite the bigger animals. How do they survive? How is it that there are waterfalls? There are places when there are waterfalls even in March, April. What luxury in the heated time of the year that you have this torrential water flowing down. And in some places you can even go there and paddle around in that water and feel the experience of waterfalls. Each one of these things is a learning by itself. And along with life skills, these vacations can bond you together. If you have an extended family, if you have grown apart from your siblings and you're living in two different cities, tell them, let's meet instead of we coming to your place or you coming to our place. Let's meet in a vacation place. You come from there, I come from here. And our families get together and we spend some quality time and we redeem our relationship, which slowly, slowly gets little diluted because we are so busy in our own lifestyles. Children don't get, many families only have single children. Or even if you have two children, let them have the pleasure of knowing their cousins. This is the time when they are growing up, when if they learn to understand that other than me, if I'm a single child, or other than me and my one sibling, there are other people who are my relatives, who are my kith and kin. And the bonding, if it develops in the growing years, it continues into adult life. If that does not happen, then they don't connect to their uncles or aunts or cousins or whoever it is. Similarly, if you live in a big city, you may be having elders or you may be having some people who live in small towns or maybe even villages if you're lucky. That is an experience which you should not deny. Children living in metropolitans and big cities should spend a few days in a village because that is their roots. That is where real life emerges from. They should experience what life is. Even today, more than half the population of our country lives in villages. We should know what happens at the other end. When these children grow up and when they are into, you know, different types of activities or whatever professions they are in, they have to know that more than half of their consumers are people who live in villages. And if they spend time in the villages now, they will understand so much. So this in a nutshell is the message that I wanted to give you so that, you know, I wanted to sort of shake you up and make you think. But remember, vacations are not limited to the once in the year summer vacation. Take small vacations. You have a long weekend, get out. If you have a car, take it and just zoom off with your family or get into a bus and go somewhere 1 or 2 or 3 hours away from your place. Enjoy the weekend and come back. Times when you're not getting that opportunity, take a Sunday vacation. Take your children out the whole day into some park or nature or resort or somewhere and come back at the end of the day. All types of vacations are very, very important for everyone from elders to the working people to homemakers right down to children. So that was my message. Let me take my quick break and Meera is here to update you on what's happening in Banjara and then I will be back.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. And I hope this topic is very interesting for you because now exams are over, summer holidays are here, and I know most of you must be planning all your trips or you might be having people coming over. So that's going to be amazing. I would also like to update you on, like Ali was saying, that, you know, if you have great interpersonal skills or if you are that somebody who people feel attracted to talk to or feel very comfortable to share all their issues with you, then we have something for you. We have the DCS coming up. Our new batch is starting. And it's a hands-on training for you to do your counseling. And you might ask, okay, where will I use this and all that? You can use it anywhere in your environment, whether you're in schools, colleges, offices, hospitals, NGOs, even at your home. And the best part is that it also enhances your life, because you learn so many things. You learn how to be empathetic, you learn how to be non-judgmental, you learn how to listen. So DCS is there. And if you feel anyone in your environment who can benefit from this, please do let them know. Our numbers are there. We are all here. Because Banjara, also, if you feel that you need to talk to somebody, if you feel I need to share my feelings with somebody, then Banjara also has the free counseling. We do it in whatever way you're comfortable. That is email, on the phone, face-to-face, or even you can write to us. And we are always there for you. And it's very confidential and no judgment. So just walk in and have a chat with us, and we'll be very happy to hear you out. We also have the CPCS, that is the certification in presentation and communication skills. If you are someone or you know somebody who's very good with life skills, because life skills is something that we need from the time we wake up in the morning till the time we sleep. And life skills is important, because that's what rides our lives, and that's what helps us live a good, enhanced and an empowered life. So we are having a course on that also. So if you feel anybody will benefit with that, or you will benefit with that, please do come talk to us, feel comfortable, and you can also join us at that. We are also having our special educator seminar coming up. We're very, very excited for that, because it's one of a kind, and we just want to spread that awareness, and we just want to bring it to people's notice, because we see so much going on today where, children need to be addressed, and today's children are tomorrow's future. So we need to, be with them, empower them, encourage them, make them so independent that, so this is one of the kind special education seminar invite. So if you know anybody who's in this field also, please do pass it on. Even you are most welcome. And so happy holidays. And I hope all of you will enjoy your holidays, and whatever tips Ali has given you, you'll inculcate it, and you'll have your at least Sunday holiday. Yes. Have a good weekend.
Yes, now let me hear from you what holidays mean to you, what they meant to you when you were children, and how you are planning out this year's holidays. I would like to hear from as many people as possible, starting with Vinita. I remember when we as kids used to visit my nani's place in summer vacations, and with all my cousins coming too. It was so much fun, and it didn't matter what weather it used to be. And I feel due to those times we spent, we still have that bonding. It is so true, actually. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Don't deprive today's generation of what you enjoyed. Numbers may be less. That time there may have been 15 cousins or 20 cousins meeting. Now there may be only 4 or 6, doesn't matter. But as the numbers come down, we need more and more bonding, isn't it? So give your children that opportunity to bond with their extended families. Sharayu says, your speech was nostalgic for me, since my childhood was exactly the same, an eye-opener to younger generation with nuclear family. Yes, most of us elder people have those beautiful memories. In fact, after this session is over, I'd like you to take a few minutes to sit down somewhere in a calm place, close your eyes, and visualize those holidays when you were children. You probably went to your grandparents' place, or you went to some place where there was some marriage taking place, or whatever it is, or you just went to some vacation nature place. Try to recall how the trains used to be, how the buses used to be. Even if you had your own car, it would probably conk off on the highway. The radiator would overheat, and then you had to put water and allow it to cool, and then only the vehicle will take you forward. Or there used to be number of punctures, and every time there is a puncture, you have to change the wheel and go to the next town and get that puncture repaired. All that used to be an adventure. Remember to, you know, recall those and talk about them to the younger generation, right? Sridevi says, I completely agree. Vacations are the time to create lovely memories and connect with our near and dear ones. And please don't spend half your vacation taking selfies. One out photograph, yes. Photographs, now that has become so convenient with smartphones. Do click some photographs so that you have those pleasant memories. But not clicking everywhere and anywhere the moment, you know, you are more interested in taking those selfies than enjoying. I've seen people, you know, looking at the sunset. What a beautiful experience it is to just watch the sun as it goes down the horizon. But all they are doing is running from this side to that side, taking a photo here, taking a photo there, asking somebody to come and stand in front and then taking a photo. Just relax. The sun is teaching you that, see, I will take my own sweet time to set. You can't hurry me. So, and you see even a simple thing like few minutes back, the sun, which was in all its glory and, you know, giving that light and heat onto your face, now is so docile and quietly slipping away into the horizon. It shows how life can be. It is an experience of life, isn't it? Roshan says, we all need a break from the monotony of life. As a child, would always look forward to any holidays. In my summer vacation, would always go to Bombay. That is where I learned swimming as a five-year-old. Being with nature is the best way to spend holidays. Agreed. Till today, I love to travel and meet people from all walks of life. There is so much to learn. Yes, that's another very good point which Roshan has brought out. When you go on a vacation and you meet different people, no? Whether it is from urban to rural, or whether it is from Karnataka to Tamil Nadu or Uttar Pradesh, there are so many variations in people, their lifestyles, their food habits, their languages. And that itself is so fascinating if you sit down to listen to them, understand them, let them explain to you how they live their lives. I've seen that wherever there are metropolitan cities, there are nuclear families. Wherever there are small towns, they are mostly joint families. If you happen to go to a small town, see how the joint family lives, how 18 people live in one house and how they bond or how they fight with each other or whatever happens. Spend some time, if possible, stay with them and see, you know, how lifestyle is so different from everywhere else. Arzu says, Ali, as you mentioned correctly, India still lives in villages. I was fortunate enough to visit Nani's place and live that simple life. That helps enjoy a quiet day in today's materialistic urban lifestyle. This is another very good point that Arzu has brought out. You know, when you go to small towns or villages, you see that those people are not in the rat race. They're very happy with what they are doing. A person may take up a very ordinary job, and for the next 35 years, he continues doing that job. He doesn't get any promotion. He's a storekeeper in some small factory or shop or office. And he's a storekeeper 30 years later also. He has no qualms. He says, okay, I'm doing a hard day's work. I'm earning my salary. I'm taking care of my family. We learn that. And then we learn also not to be all the time running, chasing into the rat race. We see elders who live such complacent lives with their joint family. Some grandchild comes, the nani will be sitting and talking to them about the good old days. She'll probably be making some pickle, which she's an expert in, and nobody else can make that. So everybody, you know, approves of it, and everybody thanks her for making that pickle, and it is distributed to all the different extended family members. That is how life goes ahead, and that is how life should be. We don't understand the significance of these small things, you know. And wherever there is a variation in lifestyle, there is something to learn from there. Urban to rural, South India to North India, Karnataka to Kerala, a place in the middle of the land to a place which is on the seaside, a place which is 4,000 feet above sea level, and a place which is down at the sea level. Each one of these things teach us so much. And with all the issues and problems that are coming up today with global warming, ecology, deforestation, all these things that are happening, at least if we give the children a chance to learn about what is ecology, what is environment, how these things work, and what is the impact, if they can see that, a child is very quick at picking up things at times. If you had been to a particular place 5 years back, and if you take the same child there after 5 years, the child will remember and say, oh, here there used to be so many trees. I don't see that tree. Some buildings have come up over here. At that time, it was cooler, and now this place seems to be warmer. Let children experience that. Let you yourself experience that. You can't run away from whatever is happening in our environment. You may be working in an air-conditioned office. You may be living in a very comfortable house. But that does not mean that you can neglect what is happening outside. And the vacation is the one beautiful and very convenient way of learning that. Nita says, yes, I still remember my nani had a huge mango backyard. And it was so fascinating to pluck them from the trees and enjoying, which I never got to see in Bangalore. Not only plucking, just climbing up the tree and sitting there was such a joy. Teach the child how to climb trees. Teach the child, show the child what is the age of the tree. How many years it took, find out from the locals. You have this huge, lovely tree with a big span, a nice shade. You're sitting under that shade. Find out from the locals how old is the tree. And you'll be amazed. The person may say 40 years, 100 years old. So you can explain, saying that, see, today what we are enjoying is because somebody planted a tree 40 years or 80 years back over here. And only now you're getting the fruits of that gesture of that person. So what are we doing for the coming generations? Are we planting trees? Are we encouraging nature? These are the things to look into, right? Yes, Sharayu says, after vacation, writing travelogue was mandatory, which my father made it routine. Yes, I also remember that teachers often used to say, what did you do in your summer holidays, right? An essay on that. And I'm so glad that Sharayu has a father who used to make the children write, okay, you went on a vacation, or I took you on a vacation. Now write what you experienced. What did you feel about it? What did you like? What did you not like? That remains. One is it helps the child to think. And secondly, it remains as a document. If you preserve that, once you grow up, you'll be able to recall what all you did as a child, the way you bonded with different type of people and where all you went and all these things happen. This is such a wonderful thing. And as I said, please do not restrict it only to summer vacations. Namaste Ali, thanks for today's topic. Children learn many life skills and soft skills in natural setting if we live and keep visiting rural areas. I think if anyone learns anything by experience, we'll stay long. Very true. There's an impact. We don't even realize it, It is there in the subconscious mind what we have learned. Tomorrow we learn how to preserve water, how to take care of plants. It comes to us automatically, particularly if we learn this in early years of life. So that is something which I want all of you to please give enough attention to. Talk to other people who are not of that habit. People who say that, no, we'll go abroad to some fancy places. We'll go to, cities. We'll go to some Dubai and do shopping or something like that. It's okay. They want to do it. There's nothing wrong with it. But also tell them that that is not enough in life. What is needed is to be with nature and experience nature in all its variety, which is available right here in our own country. most of them not even very, very far off. They are accessible by road and by train and by bus or whatever it is. And of course, if you can afford to go by air, nothing like it, you reach there faster and you get more time to spend over there. But please do make this resolution. Connect with people, people who are not doing these things and are not conscious of it. Make them conscious. Maybe take them along. Take one or two other families with you. Join up with two, three different families. And, you know, maybe book a van or a bus or get two, three cars or whatever it is. And everybody goes along. Like you saw in one of those photos, stopping somewhere on the highway under a tree and spreading out your dari and everybody sitting and having a meal which they brought from home instead of going to a hotel or a dhaba. You eat your own homemade food over there. That is something, and you'll see those ants coming, you'll see the red ants and you'll scream and you'll want to run away from the ants. Or you may find a bullock coming over there and wanting you to share the food with him. Every one of these things is a wonderful experience by itself. Please make it a point. And that is the reason why I thought I will speak to you before March gets over, so that you have time to make the most of vacations. I know that some children have exams. Now this summative exam of the, you know, 5th, 8th, 9th and 11th standard is again going to happen from Monday onwards. So if somebody had made travel plans, now they have to give that up and finish off with the exam. Doesn't matter. All these inconveniences will come and go. But once you find that, you know, little loophole, you find that little niche, just get out and do whatever you plan to do and enjoy yourself. So with that, let me sign off and Anis will show you the topic for next week, which is why bad things happen to good people. And we will, you know, meet next Saturday and discuss the thing. Oh, we have two very nice comments. Can we take them? Lakshmi says, holidays for me were the most peaceful time of the year. I remember my father taking me to various spiritual retreats, meditation workshops and art classes during my summer vacation. So when I think about those days, I feel some sort of peace and calmness at the core of my heart. That is what is the lingering memories of vacations. Yes, Kumar Swami says, Ali, I do remember in your DCS class, you were telling, we were standing in line for tickets. If someone gets in the line, we get irritated. Now I'm recalling after 17 years. Very true. So slow down. Stop to smell the flowers. Be among nature. Enjoy yourself. Fill your lungs with fresh air and come back rejuvenated. Thank you and bye-bye.